600 plus 455. So what we shown last time was, so this tracking is, so if the y-axis shows the tracking error, it is 0 hertz and it is 1 kilohertz, and it is minus 1 kilohertz, it is plus 1 kilohertz, and so on. So over the entire range, say for example, take the commercial AM receiver, which operates from 540 to 1640 kilohertz. So it's difficult, it's almost impractical to achieve perfect zero error in the tracking. So we tune our receiver such that at the low end, at the lower end, so near 540, it is zero. At one point, the tracking error is zero. And it is also zero at the higher end of the spectrum, maybe 1600 or 1610 kilohertz or so on. And in between these two frequencies, the geometric mean of these two frequencies. What is geometric mean of xy? It is root xy, right? So if I make the tracking error zero at 600 kilohertz and tracking error zero at 1600 kilohertz, then we will also make the tracking error to be zero at the geometric mean of these two frequencies, which is square root of 600 into 1600, so which nearly comes out to be 950 kilohertz. And then we also make the tracking error zero. And in between these two frequencies, over the entire band, the tracking error may vary something like this, right? So this is the good receiver. We call this as the good receiver. It has got better tracking capabilities, and a somewhat bad tracking is this. It has zero tracking error at the lower end point, but it has again zero only at the higher end point, and in between its tracking error is different compared to this. And one very bad thing is this one. It matches only at the lower end and higher end, but at all other places its tracking error is much higher, right? So this is what we call it tracking. And so let me complete it by, yeah, maybe by saying one more sentence, then we can say. Just a minute. Yeah. Hello. Hello. I'll talk to you later, sir. Yeah. I'm in a teleconference, so please, sorry, I thought it may be some call from JNTU Kakinada, or maybe my voice got lost or something, but yeah, anyway. So what we were saying is the tracking error. An error of generally of the odd, an error of up to 3 kilohertz is acceptable, right? So generally, and also it is possible to maintain. Tracking error less than 3 kilohertz, less than plus or minus 3 kilohertz, right? So it can be plus or minus. So that is all with respect to tracking. So if we say a commercial receiver has got a tracking error of less than plus or minus 3 kilohertz, we say it's okay, it's acceptable. We can take that receiver, and also it is possible to maintain through tuned circuits that much this thing, but we will see in communications receivers what Okay, we'll see at the end of the class. There are some special class of receivers which are to be used for more specialized applications, like by professionals. So in such receivers, we need a much better specifications for such receivers. So we'll see that later. Yeah. So the tracking part is done. Now let's go to this intermediate frequency. So what we are doing is we are examining each section of the superheterodyne receiver separately, and in that we have examined the RF amplifier and then the mixer unit, the IF, the local oscillator and all these things. So in this we will discuss how do we choose the intermediate frequency and what about the IF amplifier, like some of the, see, we are not going to discuss in very much detail, like how do you design an IF amplifier, such thing, but we'll touch upon the main concepts. So what now we'll be discussing about. Intermediate frequency. And the IF amplifier. See, initially when we introduced superheterodyne receiver, we simply said that take IF frequency for the commercial AM broadcast. For the commercial AM broadcast, for the AM radio transmissions, which operate in the range from 540 kHz to 1640 kHz, we said that simply take IF to be 455 kHz. But how did we come up with that number? Why it is 455? Like, why not something else, right? So what are the considerations for choosing an IF frequency, for choosing an intermediate frequency? That we will discuss briefly now. And then there is no mathematical expression or no way of deriving this should be exactly your IF frequency. It is a flexible one, but it depends on some of the factors which we are going to discuss now. So basically the IF meaning intermediate frequency should not be very high. Are very low, right? So that is the first claim that we make, and let us see what happens. So if IF is very high, right, if IF is very high, then at high frequencies, generally, the selectivity of the tuned circuits is difficult to maintain the selectivity very good. Like the selectivity to achieve the highly select. Okay, so what does we mean? We mean selectivity and sensitivity for a receiver, right? So selectivity meaning we should be selecting only the desired radio station. We should not allow adjacent frequencies. Say there may be two radio stations operating very close to each other. So if the receiver's selectivity is bad, in the sense if the receiver also allows the other frequencies to leak into its input, then we will listen to two stations. So there are two things, right? One is adjacent frequency, another is image frequency. So image frequency is not very close to the desired frequency. Image frequency is fsi is equal to fs plus 2fi. So if you are tuning at 600 kilohertz is your desired radio station, then 600 plus 2 into 455 is the image frequency. But any station which is near 600 kilohertz is the adjacent station, right? So you should be knowing this difference between adjacent frequency adjacent frequencies meaning nearby frequencies and image frequencies. So you should not get confused between these two. Image. So for a given signal frequency, you can find these two. And if IF is very high, we need to employ specialized filters. So I'm keeping it in brackets. So this we discussed not exactly in this point. So if IF is very high, we need to employ specialized filters in the receiver as at high frequencies achieving good selectivity with simple filters. With simple filters meaning I'm talking about tuned circuits, right? Tuned circuit is a simple filter. Any RLC circuit is a filter because it passes only some frequencies. You can tune it, you can choose RLC components in such a way that it will pass some frequencies and it will attenuate the other frequencies. So as at high frequencies, achieving good selectivity with simple filters is difficult. So what does this mean? If I choose my IF frequency to be very high, my cost of the receiver will go up. I have to use some specialized filters like crystal based filters and whatever. Right, so the cost and complexity of the receiver will become high. Next, so if IF is very high, tracking becomes much more difficult. And now, tracking means that local oscillator should always be at the FS plus FI, right? That constant difference between the input filters and the local oscillator frequency should be exactly equivalent to the IF frequency. So that becomes very difficult when IF becomes very high. So we don't want IF to be very high. At the same time, now look at this. What happens when, what are the problems when IF is very low? So in that we will, yeah. So let's recall that alpha is equal to 1 plus Q square rho square. What is alpha? Image frequency rejection ratio, right? So this we discussed in the last class. So this is image frequency rejection ratio. So how much the image frequency gets rejected by the tuned circuit is equal to 1 plus Q square rho square. We computed this. We also did an example where, so what is rho? If you recall, it is FSI by FS minus FS by FS. So here what is FS? FS is the incoming signal frequency to which we want to listen. Say we want to listen to some radio station having a carrier frequency of FS, and FSI is FS plus 2FI. So this is the desired carrier frequency, this is the image frequency. Okay, Now, alpha is equal to this. So when fi is very low, fsi will be very low. When fsi is very low, rho will be very low. And your image frequency rejection ratio will be low. Right? So if fsi is close to fs, then rho will be low. And fsi will be close to fs when fi is low. Right? So let me write this down. When fi is small, fsi is close to fs, and rho becomes decreasing alpha. Thus, a very low IF value will decrease the image frequency rejection ratio. So we don't want IF to be very low. Okay? So if IF is very low, the image frequency rejection ratio is low, meaning the capability of the receiver to reject image frequencies is becoming low. That the receiver's ability to reject the image frequencies is becoming low. Okay, then so then another thing is, if IF is very low, then see at the end the IF amplifier has got a tuned circuit which is tuned to the IF frequency, which is tuned to the IF frequency, right? So if IF is very low, the tuned circuits may become very selective So when it becomes highly selective is also reduced. Its bandwidth gets reduced, and that may clip some of the side bands. Say our AM wave has got a carrier and an upper band and a lower side band. If the bandwidth is may become high of what thing of local oscillator needs to be highly stable. So why is that? What I'm saying was, any oscillator, if it is tuned to produce a frequency of f naught h, then it will not exactly, it is highly difficult for for any circuit to produce a frequency exactly at f naught. So it will produce at f naught plus or minus delta f. So for example, if we are operating at 1 megahertz, or say if we are operating at 1000 kilohertz, right? And if the oscillator stability is right, and then say for example now we are operating at only 500 kilohertz, then 500 plus or minus 10 kilohertz is much higher variation. So this variation of 10 kilohertz is a significant portion of 500 kilohertz, but it is not so significant portion of 1000 kilohertz. So when you look at in 1000 kilohertz, 10 kilohertz is how much percentage? 10 by 1000 into 100, right? So it's 1%, it's 1% variation, but here it is 2% variation. So when the IF is low, your local oscillator frequency should always be f naught is equal to fs plus fi. So when fi is very low, your local oscillator frequency will become low. That means your local oscillator should be operating at a lower frequency, and whenever any oscillator is operating at a lower frequency, even a small drift in its frequency will constitute a big error. That's what I mean to say. So if fi is very high, then local oscillator will be operating at a higher frequency, and at higher frequency even a few hertz drift of the local oscillator frequency will be only a small percentage. It's not a big percentage. So that's the reason why if IF is very low, the local oscillator needs to be highly stable. So that means we have seen a couple of reasons why it should not be very high, why it should not be very low, right? And there is one final requirement. Okay, we have seen that it cannot be very high, it cannot be very low, but also at the same time, IF should not be in the frequency range of operation. What do we mean by this? See, say for example, if you take commercial AM band, we are operating from 540 kilohertz to 1640 kilohertz. Right? So the IF should not be in this band. So in this band, all the radio stations are operating in this band, the commercial medium wave radio stations. And your IF should not be within this range. If IF is within this range, the receiver will becomes unstable, and it is highly difficult, it is almost impossible to tune to a station near to the IF frequency. Near to the IF. Say if IF is in between these in this range, then what I'm trying to say is that it is very, very difficult to tune to a station next to the IF frequency. So think about it think why, right? So you can discuss with your friends or your professors, whatever. Okay, so we have seen that IF cannot be very high, IF cannot be very low, and it should not lie in the frequency band of operation. So as I said, there is no exact mathematical rule that if we solve some equations, we will get this IF. So how people designed was based on years of experience. So based on years of experience, the IF frequencies were so why do I say frequencies? Because in the following we will also see what are the IF frequencies for FM transmission. What is the IF frequency for FM transmission? What is the IF frequency for radar systems, for microwave systems, and for television systems more importantly? So all these things, as I said at the beginning of discussing, when we started discussing super heterodyne receiver, what I said was the principle of super heterodyne is a very general principle. It can be applied to any receiver, not only to amplitude modulation receiver. It can be applied to any other kinds of receiver. So it is being applied to television reception in the television receivers, in FM receivers, in radar systems, and even in microwave frequencies, microwave communication systems. So, but all the time we were discussing amplitude modulation and the commercial AM broadcast, because that's just a very easy example for us, and very interesting also, because it was very interesting in those days where people were regularly listening to radios. So I'm not sure what is the radio usage nowadays, but anyway, it's one of the simplest example that we can discuss, right? And also we are accessible to radio receivers easily. You can access to a radio receiver and open it up and see all the sections, and then you can tune it, and then you can do experiments with it. Whereas it is slightly expensive to experiment on a television receiver and say, for example, when you think about radar receivers or microwave receivers, you won't even have access to see those receivers unless you go to some government office or some other establishments which use these systems, right? So based on years of experience, the IF frequencies are standardized. What do we mean by standardized? So we say that 455 kilohertz is the standard IF frequency which we use for commercial AM broadcast, right? So though they are standardized, like based on experience, they said, okay, you use 455 kilohertz for IF. It's good. That's it. But at the same time, you should keep in mind that it is not strictly required to use 455 kilohertz. Say if you want to use a slightly different IF, you are welcome to use. If you want to experiment with something or if you, yeah, it's up to your application. So let us discuss the frequencies used. So let's discuss different systems one by one. One is standard commercial AM. Commercial AM broadcast. Mainly we are looking at this medium wave frequencies, 540 kilohertz to 1640 kilohertz, and also, okay, let me also write that. So the AM transmission also happens in the other band. And also over the band 6 to 18 megahertz. So the experience tells us that use an IF, intermediate frequency, in the range 438 kilohertz to 465 kilohertz, right? But the more popular one is but more commonly used IF is 455 kilohertz. Right, so for commercial AM broadcast operating within this range and also this range, use an IF in the range of 438 kilohertz to 465 kilohertz. So this, as I said, this is based on various experimental trials people did and based on their experience they were saying that. But this 455 is fairly common, like most of the transmissions use, most of the receivers use this 455, right? Yeah. So yeah, hope you have noted it. And then let's go back to FM receivers. So the commercial FM receivers FM transmission, commercial FM transmission happens in the range from operating in the range 88 kilohertz to 108 kilohertz. Right, so your radio Mirchi and everything comes in this frequency range. Right, whatever FM you have, FM radio stations. Use 10.7 megahertz as IF. So for FM it is 10.7 megahertz, and then let's come to TV receivers. Television receivers. So television receivers operate in two bands, right? VHF and UHF. I think television engineering might be an elective course for you in your final year or third year. So VHF is in VHF band. So the transmissions happens in the VHF band, which is 54. I doubt what it is. 54 to 223. And 470. So this is UHF. So VHF is this, and UHF band is 470 megahertz to 940 megahertz. So for these both the bands, use an IF. We use an IF between 26 to 46 megahertz. Is it right? 26 to 46 megahertz. See, just like in AM broadcast, we said that we should use IF in the range from 438 to 465 kilohertz. So here we want to use IF within this range, 26 to 46 megahertz. But the commonly used IF frequencies are 36 megahertz range, generally. Right, so now you have got introduced. it sends out a pulse at some energy, and it goes, and if there is a target, it hits that back. That it operates in two bands, VHF band and UHF band, but for both the bands we use the IF frequency is recommended to be between 26 megahertz to 46 megahertz, and the commonly used IF are 36 megahertz and 46 megahertz. And finally, this microwave and radar. So microwave and radar receivers. So as I said, radar is used mainly for defense applications, right? So a transmitter sends a pulse, and if there is any reflected pulse, it will try to detect that okay, there is a target at so and so distance and so on. And then microwave communication is also used for your base stations to communicate with each other. Your towers, right, cell phone towers, they are connected with each other through either fiber or through microwave, and microwave is heavily used in police and military communications and so on. So this microwave and radar communication receivers, they operate in what is their frequency of operation, range of frequency of operation, operate in 1 gigahertz to 10 gigahertz, and their IF is use IF, say three different frequencies are suggested: 30 megahertz, 60 megahertz, or 70 megahertz. So use IF as 30 megahertz or 60 megahertz or 70 megahertz. So this is for microwave and radar receivers. So these are the different IF frequencies for different systems. So we have seen commercial AM broadcast, commercial FM broadcast, television receivers, which is also commercial transmissions, and then microwave and radar receivers, which are not commercial. They are for more specialized applications, mainly for governments and then some business entities, right? So here one thing common you can see is, so whenever say for example here, so here I found a mistake. FM receivers operating in the range, it's not kilohertz, it's megahertz. Right, so FM happens from 88 megahertz to 108 megahertz. It's not kilohertz, sorry for that. Because for kilohertz, your IF cannot be in megahertz. Right, so please make this change. Maybe most of you know about FM transmissions, and if you listen to they say it's Radio Mirchi or whatever, and they say that FM frequency, that frequency is always, you can observe that it is in between in this range, 88 megahertz to 108 megahertz, right? So one common thing you can observe is that generally this IF frequency is, if there is a band of operation, if it is being operated from F1 hertz to F2 hertz, then your IF is generally lower than F1. So if the range of operation is from F1 to F2. So say this can be AM or FM or television, then your IF is generally somewhere here, which is IF is generally less than your F1. But here in and it is near to F1, so somewhere closer. But here in microwave and radar receivers, it is much less than. See, they operate from 1 gigahertz to 10 gigahertz, but the IF can be much lower than 1 gigahertz. Right? So this is just one observation. It doesn't have any much significance to it. So, yeah. So now that is about IF frequencies. Now let's think about IF amplifier. So as I said, we will just briefly discuss one or two points on IF amplifier. So what is IF amplifier? So one thing that comes readily to our mind is IF is a fixed frequency amplifier. That meaning it need not operate at multiple frequencies, because the IF signal comes out from the mixer, right? So it's a fixed frequency amplifier, and it should have so let's not write 1 and 2, that will be confusing. It should have high selectivity. High selectivity to reject adjacent frequencies. So you should note that IF amplifier cannot reject image frequencies. See, the image frequency rejection is the task of the front end, the initial antenna coupling circuit and the RF amplifier. So the antenna coupling circuit and the RF amplifier should be able to reject your image frequency. But once the image frequency comes up to the input of the mixer, the mixer output will have IF signal corresponding to the image frequency, as well as IF signal corresponding to the desired frequency. And IF amplifier cannot do anything. IF amplifier will amplify both the IFs, one IF corresponding to the image frequency, another IF corresponding to the desired frequency, and then you will listen to two stations simultaneously. So the image frequency rejection should happen before the mixer. So the first one is antenna coupling circuit, then the RF amplifier, if there is an RF amplifier. So these two stages, If you cannot suppress the image frequency, and once it reaches up to the mixer input, you cannot avoid the radio station corresponding to the image frequency. So what is the task of IF amplifier? IF amplifier should pass only 455 plus or minus 3 kilohertz. Like, it should not allow the station sitting very next to the desired station. Right, so its frequency is mainly to reject, its selectivity is mainly to reject adjacent frequencies. And generally there are the IF amplifier can be made from FETs, field effect transistor, bipolar junction transistor, BJT and IC based amplifier. IC means integrated circuit, right? So in both, say for example, when you use it, so both FET and IC based IF amplifiers in general will have two tuned circuits, or in general, okay, let's call that as in, rather than will have, they are generally double tuned amplifiers. What do we mean by double tuned is they will have a tuned circuit at the input and they will have another tuned circuit at the output in general. Are double tuned amplifiers having one tuned circuit at the input and the other at the output. And they are single stage amplifier generally. So what do I mean? So if you look at an IF amplifier which is constructed with FET, generally it is a single stage amplifier, like there are no two stages cascaded with each other. It's a single stage amplifier having two tuned circuits, one in the input and one in the output. But when BJT based, say bipolar junction transistor, so BJT based IF amplifiers or single tuned but two stage amplifiers. Means it will have tuned circuit only at the output of the amplifier, but there are two stages, like the input signal is first applied to one transistor amplifier which amplifies it to certain extent, and that amplified signal is given to the second stage. The second stage amplifier further amplifies it. So the gain, to achieve better gain, generally with BJTs we use a two stage amplifier, but it will have only a single tuned circuit at the output. So why we cannot have two tuned circuits in the BJT based transistors is kind of, there are some deep reasons for this which you should be able to understand if you thoroughly study this circuit analysis, like electronic circuits, right? You would have discussed class A, class B, class C amplifiers, biasing, all these things. So our purpose in this course is not to go into details of how to construct circuits for communication, for amplitude modulation, for FM modulation. Our focus is more on understanding how they work and the mathematical principles behind it. So what is modulation, why frequency conversions, and how the noise affects, and how to receive. So it's more of a block diagrammatic approach. So we know that we need to have a RF amplifier, we need to have a mixer, we need to have a local oscillator, and we need to have IF amplifier, audio amplifier, that so on, so forth. So the intricacies of exactly designing an amplifier or a submodule of this communication system. So you need expertise also in the circuit designing, the analog circuits or digital circuits, right? So anyway, so these are some of the main points of IF amplifier. So if we start actually thinking about designing an IF amplifier, that itself will become like a much deeper topic to discuss. So now we'll move on to the next topic, which is based on automatic gain control, which is about automatic gain control. So which is another important aspect in a radio receiver. So diode detector. So this is more like practical. So next topic is practical envelope detector. So we also call simply as diode detector, because what is the main component in an envelope detector? There is a diode and then there is an RC. There is a resistor and there is a capacitor. That's it, right? So it's mostly called, it can also be called as a diode detector. Practical envelope detector and AGC. So what is AGC? AGC is automatic gain control. So we'll discuss this topic now. So let's quickly recall what is a diode detector. Then we will go into what is a practical diode detector, which is used. Okay, so the diode detector which we discussed, it gives you the principle of operation of a diode detector. Like in principle, how a diode connected with a resistor and a capacitor can detect your envelope of the modulated signal. So you might recall that something like this. This is the IF input signal. So these are the tuned circuits tuned to IF frequency. So here we have, what do we call it, VS. So the signal voltage VS, and then here is the diode, and then here you will have a resistor, and here you will have a capacitor. This is your Vout. So this is C, this is R, and this is the ground, right? So there is a diode basically, and there is a resistor and a capacitor. You can also draw this as something like this. So what happens is, you just recall, so input say this is the carrier signal, right? So this is our M of T, the baseband signal that we want to decode, demodulate, right? And so the received signal will be at IF, something like this. Sorry. Yeah. So anyway, you have seen this diagram before, and then we have seen the diagram in the book. Right. So the diode conducts in the positive when it is positive compared to this side. And then the capacitor charges fully, right? But when the RF voltage or when the IF signal decreases, the capacitor discharges through this resistor, and then it again charges, and then it again discharges, and then it again charges, discharges, it charges, and then so your recovered signal will have something like, so it should have been a smooth signal, but it will have something like this. It will be, so this will be your V naught. So this, so your V naught will be this, the output voltage. So V naught. So the key point I want to tell you is, the output voltage has three components. One is the envelope, which is equivalent to M of T. That's what we want. And it has an RF ripple. Okay, what is this RF ripple? See, the recovered signal, ideally what we want the recovered signal? The recovered signal should be something like this. This is the M of T for us. But instead of this, it again decreases, it falls. See this. Right? So it falls and then it charges again. There is some charging and then it falls again. So that is called RF ripple. So it's not a smooth M of T. You can see the previous diagram which we have discussed in troubleshooting, right? When we discussed the envelope detector. So it has got RF ripple, and most importantly, it also has got a DC value. See, we are saying that we will be detecting this envelope. So this envelope has got a DC value. What is the DC value of this envelope? That is equivalent to peak voltage of the carrier signal. So this is AC, the carrier signal peak voltage, right? This is AC, which is the peak voltage of the carrier signal, and if actually our actual baseband signal will be something like this, then if you do amplitude modulation, you get such a signal. And then the recovered signal has got a DC value. DC value proportional to the carrier signal, the carrier strength. Right. So it has got actually three components. So this is desired, and these two are undesired. So we want this, but we don't want these two things. Right? Because our baseband signal, see our M of T, the voice signal, doesn't have a, it may not be having a DC value. Right? But the resultant is having a DC value. While discussing the envelope detector in the previous classes, we said that simply here we will put a low pass. Here we will put a low pass filter, which filters out this RF ripple, right? Because the low pass filter will pass only low frequencies. So RF ripple is at the frequency, or to be specific, it is IF ripple. So this is at the frequency of IF, right? And it passes only the baseband frequencies, and we will put a capacitor in series which blocks the DC component. So you recall this. So you go back to your notes, and or you refer back to the textbook, that at the output of the diode detector or the envelope detector, we'll put a low pass filter to filter out the RF ripple, and there will be a capacitor in series. Before taking the output, the capacitor blocks the DC value present in the output of the envelope detector. So this is a theoretical envelope detector. Now let's go to the practical diode detector. So let me write, this is okay. So anyway, this is not the practical one. So a practical diode detector is as follows, right? So diode detector is as follows. So let me draw this diagram. So see, this diagram is slightly drawn in a different way from the book. So again, this I'm teaching from Kennedy, Electrical Communication Systems Kennedy, so which I mentioned in the last class also. So this is the third edition, Electronic Communication Systems by Kennedy and Davison. So you can see all these diagrams. So anyway, here this figure in a slightly different manner. So this is IF input. So this is capacitor. So this is the input stage of the diode detector, and here the diode is connected in the reverse direction. And then comes the C. So this is C. This is R1. Then C1. So we'll discuss what are these, R1, C1, R2, R3. This R2. There is this R3. So this is audio frequency output, right? And then C3. This is AGC out. So the voltage which comes out here is used for automatic gain control. Okay, let's now discuss about this circuit. See, so first of all, if you see, IF is given through a tuned circuit, and IF is coming through another tuned circuit to the diode detector. And we know that the diode detector should have R and C. So the C is kept intact, and we have added some more C's here, okay, that we'll see. But the resistor R is splitted into two components, R1 and R2. So now compare this with the previous diagram. So here we need an R and a C and a diode D. So the diode here is connect, okay, sorry. So here the diode detects the positive envelope when you connect it. But if you reverse the diode, if you reverse the diode, and then it will detect the negative envelope. So this I asked you to do as a homework in when we discussed the envelope detector, right? So what happens when the diode gets connected in the opposite direction? So it will still detect the M signal, but it will detect the opposite envelope, which is negative envelope. So here exactly the same thing happened. Here the diode is reversed. So diode is reversed. It will now detect negative envelope . So that means the DC component will also be negative, right? See, if it detected the positive envelope, the DC value of that positive envelope is a positive. But if it detects the negative envelope, the DC value will be negative. So that negative DC value, we will use it for automatic gain control. Right? So that's why we detect the negative thing. And that's one observation. Diode is reversed compared to the theoretical diode detector. And another observation is the resistor R is split into R1 and R2. So this R1 and R2 together constitute that resistor R. Okay. So that's that simply it is that resistor R is split into two resistors. And then here let us see this R1 C1, the pair R1 C1 forms a low pass filter that filters out the RF ripple. That filters out the RF ripple. So this R1 C1 is, so we need to filter out the RF ripple, so that the that is getting filtered. And then C2 is the coupling capacitor. C2 acts as a coupling capacitor and blocks the DC value in the output of the detector. So we said RF ripple should be filtered. Okay, RF ripple is getting filtered, and then the DC value should not reach to the loudspeaker. Okay, so what is the output of this diode detector? At the end of the diode detector, there is an audio frequency amplifier, right? So we should receive only the audio frequencies, not the DC value and all. So the DC value is getting filtered by C2. So that this output goes to the audio frequency. So audio frequency amplifier. So here comes AF amplifier. AF audio frequency amplifier. So what is this? This is volume control. So it's a potentiometer, right? So if I change this resistance, the output is taken from here to here. So this is the audio frequency output, which goes to audio frequency amplifier. So if I change the potentiometer, my output voltage level will change. So that means my sound, the volume control in the radio receiver changes this exactly. And now what is this? So till this, it is in line with whatever we discussed so far. So we need to have a diode, we need to have an RC circuit, and we have to filter out the RF ripple, and we have to block the DC component. But here there is something additional, which is R3C3, another R3C3. So this R3C3 also acts as a low pass filter. But what it filters? It filters the audio frequencies, and then it gives only the DC value at the output. So at this output, we get only the DC value. So by see at this point, what we have is the RF ripple got filtered. Still, it has got DC value, and it has got the signal at this point has got DC value, and it has got audio frequencies. So these audio frequencies will be filtered by this low pass filter, and then outputs only the DC. Whereas the same signal which goes via this path, the DC gets filtered out, and only the audio frequencies will be present. Right? So the pair R3C3 So what happened? Somebody got the control of my screen, or I don't know why is this happening. See, is it some virus or? I don't know. I lost the control over my tablet and pen. So these lines are coming all of a sudden on their own. So maybe I'll close this application once, and then I'll restart it. Like, hello. So Asghar, like there is some problem. I'm getting like my the control of my pen and tablet are not in my hands. Like, there is some bug or something. So let's see, again, restarting this application will take some time. Anyway, we have 10 minutes more. So we'll stop the class here, and then I'll try to fix up my laptop, I guess, or one important assignment announcement is that I wanted to have an extra class tomorrow, if that is possible, because I missed one of the class last week, right? So last week or last to last week, one class I missed. So I want to have that class tomorrow. If you have any free slot, maybe I'll talk with Asghar and the JNTUK staff, the technical staff, and they will let you know. And I need to, I hope I can solve this problem of this, my tablet, and then this one, right? Yeah, so we'll the JNTUK will inform you if there is a class tomorrow. If there is any problem, we'll meet regularly on Thursday's class, next day after tomorrow, which is at 9 o'clock. Yeah, so that's all for today. So thanks.